and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where moviegoers did not care for the chocolates that Hollywood gave them for Valentine's Day. In fact, after a dismal Super Bowl weekend as well, 2019 is turning out to be a real programming debacle for Hollywood. Take this weekend, President's Day weekend, which has the potential to be a perfect storm at the multiplex, bookended by Valentine's Day. We're talking primo movie-going days. Especially thanks to 50 Shades of Grey. Yes, we have to thank it for something. That movie, you know, especially the first one, I feel there were some interesting elements about it. It had an effect on Hollywood, and one of them was the box office. So that movie and Kingsman in 2015 made this a huge release date for Hollywood, with movies like Deadpool and Black Panther, so far being the ultimate of what this weekend could accomplish, posting summer-esque opening weekends. And to be fair, Dark Phoenix was supposed to open this weekend before Fox replaced it with Alita Battle Angel. And if Dark Phoenix was a good movie, this would have been a good release date for it. Bond 25 was supposed to open this weekend next year, but just blinked, I believe because Cary Fukunaga is directing it and doesn't have a commercial bone in his body. I don't know why they picked him. We'll see. I had today on BTT Live, I was saying I have the same concerns about Denis Villeneuve with Dune. These aren't commercial directors. I wouldn't give either one of them more than $50 million to play with as a budget. But anyway, Bond has moved to April 2020. And while a mystery Disney live action movie is still sitting on this weekend next year, I think that Warner Brothers should really move Birds of Prey back just one weekend to this weekend for 2020, with Valentine's Day falling on a Friday. And with Thursday night showings, those could be for Galentine's Day, which is a perfect holiday for the Birds of Prey film. Although, after this year, you know, looking at these numbers, I can see why Hollywood might be a little bit afraid of this weekend as well. I wouldn't call it like another cursed weekend like Memorial Day just yet, but it's real iffy. I mean, you could have a Deadpool or a Black Panther, but you could also have an Alita Battle Angel, because this weekend Alita was in line with how films used to perform on this date before 2015 with 50 Shades and Kingsman. I'm talking RoboCop, Die Hard, and Ghost Rider 2. And let's be honest, I think that while we can see Birds of Prey as a Deadpool or a Black Panther, we could also see it fitting with this group of movies as well. Maybe you shouldn't have made it that way, Hollywood. Something to think about, right? I mean, they should have been like, is this like only a B kind of niche movie? We'll talk about Hollywood and how they should be a little bit, have their eyes open a little bit more when they're putting these projects together. But yes, pre-2015, these were the kinds of movies that opened for Valentine's Day, President's Day weekend. Not exactly dark days for Hollywood, because they would flood the weekend with a couple of moderate picks, but with only Alita really only able to shine this weekend, this happens to be the lowest box office for Hollywood, again, for this date, since 2001. Oh, so bad! Wall Street, as the trades are saying, is not going to be too happy. Although, I don't think that Wall Street ever has too much of an effect on Hollywood, because Hollywood has so many different platforms. You know, they have the streaming, they've got the theme parks, they've got television. There's so much stuff where Hollywood can make a buck. It's, you know, one bad weekend. And maybe that's why Hollywood spoiled a little bit, if the consequences aren't as great. Now, as for Alita, yes, once again, we're reminded that it's not wise to bet against James Cameron, as his passion project, well, not so passionate that he was willing to direct it, right? But anyway, he was involved with it, and sure enough, it managed to significantly beat expectations. This is how low expectations were, and it got a little over 40 for like the long weekend, not just the weekend, but we're talking like Valentine's Day and Monday all rolled in there. But with Alita hitting China this coming Friday and Cameron working hard to promote it there, Fox and he are hoping to make this another Ready Player One, which industry analysts say would allow Alita to at least break even, and that it could make a lot of money in the ancillary market. We'll get there, don't worry. Now, the trades, this really annoyed me. The trades are claiming that if it ain't Marvel, audiences aren't willing to take a chance on sci-fi. And Mortal Engines is another example. Really? You're going to compare and say that if it weren't for audience biases that Mortal Engines and Alita Battle Angel would be as successful as the Marvel films. That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. I didn't see Mortal Engines, to be fair, but I did see Alita, which I thought was, you know, it was a good but niche film. I think obviously what's really happening is that audiences with more entertainment choices than ever will no longer buy a ticket to whatever Hollywood puts in front of them, which, you know, also has spoiled Hollywood, because that was the case for so long. And you know, they thought the TV when it first showed up was going to be a problem, but I think streaming and video games, the rise of video games like ever before, is what's really undercut Hollywood. Because it used to be when these shows came out just once a week, that wasn't enough entertainment. But now streaming is dropping like 13-hour movies with Umbrella Academy this weekend. I'd be curious what Umbrella Academy's numbers are, because the ad campaign for it wasn't that good. Does Netflix need to run that good an ad campaign these days? I'll be curious. What did you guys watch this weekend? Did you head out to the multiplex, or were you streaming something? I mean, it's hard to compete with a 13-hour movie, which, by the way, is included with the fee you're already paying for Netflix, right? Also, I think that moviegoers have become quite savvy and are able to spot a bad or mediocre movie a mile away. And it's not fair to say that to Alita. Again, I thought it wasn't a great movie, but it was a good niche film. But not only for moviegoers to spot a bad or mediocre movie, but one that isn't worth paying to see in theaters. I feel that Alita Battle Angel will do quite well on streaming. We'll get to that in just a moment. But I'd also like to point out that James Cameron, while he's pushing the flick very hard, it's not really a James Cameron movie. This is really a Robert Rodriguez and a Leda Kalogridis movie with no big stars. And that, when you think of that, that makes a lot more sense with how Alita has turned out both creatively and financially at the box office. I mean, everyone was saying, oh, we have this James Cameron movie. And it's like, no, you have a Robert Rodriguez, Leda Kalogridis movie. And quite frankly, the movie's really overperforming for those two, right? I mean, Alita will likely break even. It got an A- cinema score. And it's particularly popular with guys over 25. Which I think means it'll likely end up where it clearly should have been all along, as I've been saying in my reviews for it, both spoiler and non, and that's that it should be a streaming series, and with the Disney-Fox merger, likely on Disney Plus or Hulu. Now, speaking of the Disney-Fox merger, this is rumored to be Fox's last release as an independent studio. Oh, so sad. I really still feel that this maybe shouldn't have been allowed to happen. We'll see what comes of it. I hope that Disney allows Fox to somewhat maintain its own identity. It's said that post the merger, I think it's an acquisition, obviously, Fox will release just about 4 to 5 movies a year. They better be really good, all right? Like all Bohemian Rhapsodies. But anyway, I heard from some Fox peeps that they thought that this acquisition would be done by now and that the Disney machine would have been behind Alita, which might have been a good idea considering its Pinocchio Disney Princess mashup, but that's what it is. There's some chatter from the trades, another excuse, right? They're trying, maybe because Fox is dying, they're like, oh, let's be nice to them. But anyway, they're like, oh, it was a difficult movie to advertise, right? They're like, who's the target audience? It's a Robert Rodriguez, Leda Kalogridis movie. This is the best I think that it could do. I mean, studios really need to be more careful in who they hire and stop being surprised when they get exactly what they paid for. Aladdin, right? They're like, oh my god, it's a Guy Ritchie movie. And you're like, that's who you hired. All right, so anyway, as for the holiday weekend's other two new releases, Happy Death Day 2 was such a stinker, it made Isn't It Romantic look good. They're like, whoo, at least it's not Happy Death Day 2. But the truth is that both films seriously underperformed, with Happy Death Day 2 making audiences feel like they'd be stuck in a time loop if they saw it, so many of them said, no thanks. And surely, I think news that Isn't It Romantic is a streaming film outside the United States, Canada, like there are like a handful of countries that are going to play it in theaters, but for the most part, it's a streaming film. And I think a lot of people, I know people, as I've told you, who said, well, then I'm just going to wait to stream it as well. If they didn't use their A-list, and that's another good way to see this movie. But anyway, does the same fate await Warner Brothers Netflix's next co-project, and that's Shaft? I'd be nervous if I were Shaft's producers and stars. Now, Happy Death Day to You, let's go back to that for a second, is particularly alarming for Jason Blum, as it's his lowest opening outside of the movies he releases himself. And when you look at those numbers, you're like, why do you release movies yourself, Jason? You clearly can't do it. Especially Upgrade. That's criminal how overlooked that movie was. But, you know, Lee Whannell recovered like crazy. He's doing The Invisible Man for Universal, and I'll put it up here, but he signed for another amazing project as well. Lee Whannell's doing fine, and hopefully he'll employ Logan Marshall partial grade. His star an upgrade. But anyway, maybe he's like, sorry, you look too much like Tom Hardy, and I'm not letting you bring down any more of my movies. Oh, that's sad, because Logan Marshall Green was so good in Upgrade. But anyway, this is the lowest opening for a Jason Blum movie outside of his own shingle since the last Paranormal Activity movie in 2015, which, by the way, was the last sequel ever for that franchise. So don't expect to see any more Happy Death Day films. And the last thing Blum needs is for his horror foundation to crack, especially with Warner Brothers coming at him so hard. Luckily, he has Us and Ma coming up next, and we'll see how those do at the box office. I think Us is certainly... We'll see what Us... I'm very curious to see how, you know, sophomore efforts are very difficult, and I'll be curious to see how Jordan Peele fares. Also, Fighting With My Family opened in 4 theaters and delivered, to its credit, a solid per theater average. But let's hope this pre-release strategy doesn't undercut the flick's opening numbers this coming weekend, where it needs all the help it can get. Just because it's like, it's a small movie, and MGM is not the strongest of distributors. Oh, good luck, Bond, which is being distributed by MGM instead of Sony this time around. MGM's like, Bond will make us a big deal, or will you just bring Bond down? Anyway, as for the overall top 10, The Lego Movie 2 had a very strong hold in its second weekend, which certainly helps after its lackluster debut. However, it's still very unlikely to come anywhere close to the first two and most successful Lego movies. It's doing better than Ninjago, but that's no trick. Ironically, with the plot of The Lego Movie 2 trying to avoid being put in the bin of storage, it looks like that's exactly where any developing Lego scripts are headed. But once again, the best holds of the weekend were The Upside and Green Book. These two little movies that could? Well, Glass, to its credit, has edged past the century mark. Although speaking of Kevin Hart and him having audiences rally behind him, it looks like the same is happening at a much smaller scale to Liam Neeson, as Cold Pursuit had a okay hold in its second weekend, indicating that while he's clearly lost some fans, some are certainly sticking by him. As for this coming weekend, it's the Oscars! I'm going to live tweet them. I hope you'll watch with me. And if anything really great happens, I'll be covering them immediately afterwards. Otherwise, my review will go up in the AM, like Black Panther or Lady Gaga winning. But don't get too excited. I think it's going to be a Roma night. Has anyone watched that yet? It's good. I'm telling you, if you read the articles that I gave you in the video description for my review, it's good. And the more, I feel bad because the more, it's a movie that needs to gestate. You need to digest it. Because the more I think about it, the more I'm really impressed with it. So I hope that you'll try. You got 1 week to watch it, because I think after it wins, everyone's going to just be like, peace out. So this is like the week that you should be watching Roma. Anyway, though, for Hollywood, it'll still be business as usual, as they're releasing 2 movies, How to Train Your Dragon 3 and Fighting With My Family. Dragon, now a Universal franchise, as I've pointed out before, every single entry in this franchise has been released by a different studio, but Universal looks like it's going to be able to do on par with the other films with the opening. And it already has 172 overseas, with China still to go. I don't know if it's going to do as well as the second one, but it's certainly going to do respectfully at the box office. So that's this weekend's movie math. Thanks so much for going over the box office with me. Be sure to share your thoughts down below. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.